Lines. I'm usually here joined by one of our meteorologists talking about the forecast, but for good reason, we're switching things up because it's not every day we can see a glowing red moon. Early tomorrow morning on Pi Day, yeah, it's 314 or the 14th of March, right? The third month of the year, 14th day of that month. So take a look and take a moment to check out the night sky because we're going to have a magnificent sight. This is our moon, sun, and Earth all aligning, causing our moon to appear red. So to talk more about the lunar eclipse is NASA expert Ernie Wright. Ernie, great to see you this morning.
Good morning. Glad to be here.
Now let's talk about this. It's not often Earth is positioned precisely between the moon and sun. But what happens during this alignment that gives us that lunar eclipse?
Well, during a lunar eclipse, the moon is passing into the shadow of the Earth, and that red color is actually all of the sunrises and sunsets around the Earth being projected onto the face of the moon. It's really beautiful.
Yeah, and what defines a partial lunar eclipse from a total lunar eclipse, and why tomorrow are we going to see that moon appear red?
So over the course of a few hours, the moon is going to be moving into that shadow of the Earth, the central shadow, and before it gets all the way there, the shadow will appear to be taking a bite out of the moon. And that bite will get larger and larger, and that's the partial phase. As soon as the moon has completely entered that central shadow, it's a total lunar eclipse, and that lasts for about an hour. And then after that, you can see that bite sort of recede.
Wow. And I think a lot of viewers are saying, do we need anything special so we can witness the eclipse?
That's one of the lovely things about a lunar eclipse. You don't need any special glasses. You don't need any special equipment. All you need is clear skies and your naked eyes.
Okay, we like that. And, you know, our space coast is, of course, a vital part of Central Florida. Space exploration, quite literally, hits home for so many who work as part of it. How are observations from LRO helping pave the way for astronauts to live and work on the moon with NASA's Artemis campaign?
Yeah, I'm envious of folks who are living close to the space coast because it would be great to just take an hour-long drive out to see a launch. Lunar Reconnaissance Orbiter has been in orbit around the moon since 2009. I was there at Kennedy Space Center when it was launched. It has been producing global maps of the color of the moon, which tells us something about the composition of the surface, and of the shape of the moon, which gives us where all of the craters are located and how deep they are. And that's what produces all the dramatic shadows on the moon. It's also measuring the radiation environment. It's measuring temperature. So we're learning a great deal about the moon that's making it come alive. It's no longer a dead rock in the minds of the scientists that study it.
Yeah, so impressive. And I think some of our viewers and myself, we're thinking about how we can learn more of the moon and even about this eclipse. Is there somewhere you want to point us?
Yeah, absolutely. Science.nasa.gov/moon. There's an article there about this eclipse. It has the exact timing and what you should expect to see. But that site also has a lot of other articles that explain all the things that we're learning from LRO and what we can do to better appreciate the moon.
Yeah. So many of us are getting up early. I'm going to do that a little earlier in the morning just to check it out. Thank you so much, our NASA expert, Ernie Wright, for joining us this morning.
My pleasure. Thank you.
Yeah, and we do want to give you a snapshot. These are key times for tomorrow's total lunar eclipse. The phenomenon is going to begin dark and early at 1:09 and end at 4:47 in the a.m. The weather is going to play a big role in things. So ahead at 9:18, we'll check in with First Warning meteorologist